emerged of Lake Victoria, a lake more than half the area of England. This stretch of water gives the adjoining land its island-like climate and heavy rainfall, rainfall which is indispensable to a place called Quericho, 60 miles east of the lake. For Quericho, almost 7,000 feet above sea level, is the center of the largest tea-growing area in East Africa. Here, in 1925, the Kenya Tea Company planted out the first 60 acres of tea which pioneered tea growing in East Africa. Today, this has developed into a vast green table, a unified group of 15 estates with names like Kimugu, Kimari, Karenga, Chabawan, Ngoina, Tagabi, and of course the one from which it all began, Quericho. And as there are acres, so there must be people to work them. 10,000 people, 10,000 Africans. They are recruited from the tribal reserves. Some form a casual labor force, coming to Quericho for 6 monthly periods, but others come with their families to begin an entirely new life. A life that starts shortly after sunup every working morning. Attending the 7 o'clock muster is tantamount to saying, "I'm fit and reporting for work." It's a routine on every estate, principally to enable the manager to set the day's work in the fields. While the manager, the field headman, and the estate head boy spend a few moments discussing some inevitable problem, the day's work begins. It begins on the development of the future tea lands, the cultivation of thousands of acres of the mature green table, the herding of 2,000 head of cattle, which supply manure for the tea bushes, the felling of 2,000 acres of fuel trees. Quericho covers all aspects of agriculture, but it has an industrial side too, the various factories, in which the green leaf crop is transformed into packets of tea, generating plant to supply the factories with power, maintenance to all this machinery and the buildings that house it, regular upkeep to the many other buildings that make up a tea estate and its villages. New buildings, like the central hospital, must replace older ones. Workers' houses must be built, the latest one based on the design of the traditional African hut. And doing all these different jobs are Africans, skilled and unskilled, headmen and laborers, 10,000 Africans who are the lifeblood of Quericho. But the community is not entirely African. In fact, the people of three continents give of their labor, skill and ability to make Quericho tick over. Each race is helpless without the contribution of the other two. Perhaps this interdependence is best seen in the relationship between manager and headman. The watch says it's midday. The sun agrees, so it's knocking off time. For the African field worker, this is the end of the working day, a working day of 6 hours. For manager and headman, this is the beginning of their daily tour of the estate, inspecting today's work and planning tomorrow's. While the men move off to, where? Well, if this is a certain day, it'll be pay office first stop. After this, there's the ration issue to collect. Usually this consists of vegetables, milk, and ground maize. The maize, called posho, being the chief item in the African's diet. Next, it might be a visit to the butchery. Then, whatever is wanted, from pins to pop, the village duca will have it. And having done the shopping, she's off home. Generally speaking, the individual African tribes prefer to be grouped into separate villages where they can carry on the traditions and customs of their own particular tribe. So there are many villages spread out across the tea estates, each one a self-contained community. Immediately a family comes to work at Quericho, they're given a cottage, but only one cottage. Separate establishments for extra wives, traditional thatched huts alongside the cottage, must be built by the husband. Today, however, most young Africans keep only one wife. In the case of bachelors, four share one cottage. They also share all the household chores. An important figure in this community life is the hygiene boy. He's a sort of public health official, responsible for the cleanliness and appearance of three villages. One of his duties is to supervise the cutting of the grass around and between the cottages. Short grass not only looks good, but more important, encourages hygienic habits. Another task which he must keep an eye on is the daily collection of all rubbish from each cottage. All open rainwater drains must be kept clean and free of any stoppage. And the work of the latrine sweepers, regularly inspected. Under tropical conditions, germs and vermin breed prolifically, and strong measures are necessary to keep them in check. Every 6 months, each cottage is sprayed with a powerful germicide. Perhaps the hygiene boy's first responsibility is anti-malarial work. Fresh cases of malaria are very rare in Kericho, and will remain so while vigorous, painstaking anti-malarial precautions continue. A constant watch is kept on all static water pools and other places where the mosquito can breed. Specimens are taken of any suspicious-looking larvae and sent back to the laboratory for expert opinion. In most cases, the larvae eventually prove to be the harmless kind, but just in case this should be the exception, a larvae-killing oil is spread over the pool. A further precaution during the dangerous period from the end of January to the beginning of August is the twice weekly issue of anti-malarial tablets to field workers. These tablets are also issued to the men's families. On all estates, some 1 million tablets are swallowed every year. All this work and the whole settlement scheme is run by the welfare officer, who works closely with a medical officer. Much of the routine work of the medical department is carried out by the African medical assistant and the laboratory technicians. Under the central control of the medical department are the estate hospitals. Here, every day, the headaches, the sore throats, and the tummy aches come for treatment. These minor ailments are promptly dealt with by the dispensers. Inside the hospitals, other dispensers are attending to the more serious illnesses. For inpatients, however, these small hospitals scattered over a large area are not ideal. When finished, the central hospital with its 100 beds will house all serious cases under the one roof and simplify the medical organization. Babies are something no community can neglect. And making them her own particular department, right from the beginning of the mother's pregnancy, is a European nursing sister. The African woman has much to learn about mothercraft, but she's eager and quick to learn, if given the opportunity. In the villages, trained African teachers hold domestic science classes. The classes cover many subjects, everything from elementary hygiene to dietetics. Teaching is directed at helping the wives to run their homes better. But the more apt pupils soon display outstanding skills. The success of this entire settlement scheme depends almost entirely on the trained African, and none more so than the school teacher. The teacher's task is a difficult one in any community. In a backward one, it's doubly so. While imparting new values and standards, he must never destroy his pupils' faith in the tribal traditions and loyalties that have stood the test of the centuries. For these people, education is something serious, precious enough to spend a sweltering afternoon in a classroom. But it's not all work, and most people visit the village club at some time during the day. Kibeo, played with either pebbles or dried beans, is the traditional game. No European at Kericho has so far discovered how to play this game. Somewhere in the village, people are always to be found gathered about some popular institution like the barber. Sitting on the village green, they chatter and gossip about, well, what people the whole world over chatter and gossip about. Most Africans are great talkers with an enviable, light-hearted attitude to life's little problems. And the tribes that form Kericho's community are no exception. They know the secret of complete relaxation, but will walk 10 miles or more to support the local football team. All football matches and other sporting activities are organized, without too much emphasis on the organized, by the welfare department. The African thoroughly enjoys all these events, whether he be competitor or spectator. At the annual sports day, when all the different estates compete for a cup, one of the most popular events is throwing the javelin. Maybe the popularity of this event has something to do with the tribal fighting spears that are used as javelins, thus providing a reminder, if not a link, with the past. But the traditions of the past will always be a part of the present, while people live who remember the music and dances of their fathers. In some villages, the approach of sunset still brings out the painted dancers and traditional musical instruments like the tum. But in other villages, a vastly different tempo can be heard. Perhaps this form of dancing, more than anything, expresses the mood of uncertain people, people in the melting pot of development, people unconsciously trying to take the best out of the old way of life as the foundation merge of Lake Victoria, a lake more than half the area of England. This stretch of water gives the adjoining land its island-like climate and heavy rainfall, rainfall which is indispensable to a place called Kericho, 60 miles east of the lake. For Kericho, today this has developed into a vast green table, a unified group of 15 estates with names like Kimugu, Kimari, Karenga, Chabawan, Ngoina, Tagabi, and of course the one from which it all began, Kericho. Oh, almost 7,000 feet above sea level is the center of the largest tea-growing area in East Africa. Here, in 1925, the Kenya Tea Company planted out the first 60 acres of tea which pioneered tea growing in East Africa. And as there are acres, so there must be people to work them. 10,000 people, 10,000 Africans. They are recruited from the tribal reserves. Some form a casual labor force, coming to Kericho for 6 monthly periods, but others come with their families to begin an entirely new life. A life that starts shortly after sunup every working morning. Attending the 7 o'clock muster is tantamount to saying, I'm fit and reporting for work. It's a routine on every estate, principally to enable the manager to set the day's work in the fields.